Greetings. In the name of the Most High. I'm going to have to move from here. Roving with iPad intact. Poor iPad. I wish I wasn't so hard on things. It's already fallen twice and hit the edges, but... No, I'm not letting you out there. There's an owl out there. I know you don't understand that, but there's a big bad owl out there. They're 5 feet tall. I'm sorry. Sheesh. So I moved to El Kitchen, where I would have espresso during the broadcast because I had a rough night, folks. I had a really rough night. It's, you know, I know. I'm being called into the... There is no break. There's a change that's gone on here. And things are freed up, you know, and encumberments. Well, we'll be back on the air again. I think we'll be on WWCR live again soon, but we're going to change the format to that of a call-out show. Yes, an out-call show. We will call those we want to talk to, so it won't just become the same kind of, you know, same thing every week kind of deal, whether it's a guest or whatever. And then there'll be the traditional 1 hour, and we'll see. That could be, you know, we might return with the communion since we pioneered that years ago. So, but folks, see, here's the thing with me. I can't do anything unless I feel it. You know? And I mean, that's just the way it is. I can't do anything unless I feel it. If I don't feel a communion coming on, it doesn't happen because it's not being led by the Holy Spirit. I mean, I know the Lord says, you know, have it often. And, you know, there are people that are, you know, have schedules and the same passion on Thursday as on Sunday as on Tuesday. And they can have their scheduled communions because it's going to be the same affect, the same level of emotion, the same, you know, it's going to be the same each time. But with me, it's more like I have to be called into a communion with the Lord. And half the time, I don't deserve it. Well, maybe all the time I don't deserve it, but I mean, I don't deserve it based on my actions, behavior, thoughts, selfishness in comparison to the heroes in the Bible, let's say, or the apostles. Or I'm dry in the spirit. You know, and I know the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. I'm just being honest with you. It's, you know, the walk in Christ is not for sissies either, but it's not for big, strong men either. It's not for people with, you know, steel balls of courage either. It's not for that. That's Esau. You've heard of Esau and Jacob. Well, you know, God hated Esau because he was strong, because he didn't need God, because he could go out and conquer the world and have concubines and, you know, conquer nations and have slaves and hunt and all those things. He was very sort of Nimrod-esque. You know, Nimrod was sort of another Esau, wasn't he? You know, he could hunt and he could do things and build things and became a mighty man. And then through his will, he became a mighty man, whereas he became every bit the mighty man as the hybrids were. And I'm just going to clean this. I'm just going to have to get one more coffee here because this is, you know, this is leading up to telling you about something that happened that, you know, I'm just kind of still reeling from it, and or it wouldn't be so casual. My Krups espresso machine is about to work. Krups, do I recommend it? No, I'm always amazed if it goes another day without breaking, you know what I mean? But it has an auto shut off. You know, and I'm going to have to go to tea eventually. I know that. Thing is, the tea makes my stomach upset in the morning unless I have food with it. And sometimes you don't want food. And I think this will... I think this one will finally get me there to where I can talk to you unfettered. I might need a vape stick. I might break down and have a cigarette. I don't know. I don't really smoke a lot of cigarettes. I usually vape, but lately with all the confusion I've had around here and all the interruptions, and now we've gone on going on 7 months of having done, you know, improvements and fixed up our dwelling here. Oh, nothing really fancy, you know, just a lot of the outside work was in a way to shore up the foundation and, you know, but it, you know, there's a beautiful component of using moss rock up the sides, which, you know, in the courtyard, it's all the way up to the roof, creating this kind of stone courtyard with a floor and a, you know, in the walls of the house, and then you can sit in there. There's a little fountain. Kind of cool, but it's nothing like knocking out this wall, raising the roof 10 feet, putting in, you know, room extensions. I prayed to the Lord about it, and he said, just shore it up. Meaning, you know, to improve all the things interior and exterior that are here, keeping those things that are working, getting rid of those things that don't work, you know, in some cases, resurfacing, retiling, rather than gutting. But then again, I've done, since, you know, I have another hat as a designer, so I've done a lot of these houses over my lifetime. In fact, at one point, it was a way I made a living, that I would go in and take what I like to do, my trademark, if you will, back in L.A., and maybe I'll do it again, I don't know. Does it matter anymore? And I'll get to that in a minute. What I would do in the past is I would go into a house that I'd want to live in. I wouldn't just flip it something. And I'd move in, you know, and it would presumably have pretty good bones. It didn't have to be, you know, it could be a small house. It didn't have to be a huge house. It just had to have something going for it that attracted me, that I found interesting. That get the creative juices flowing, meaning I'd go in and I'd say, oh, I could do this here and I could do that there, and oh, I think this should go here and that should go there. And we should get this kind of furniture for here, and this kind of light should go there, and this kind of tile here, or maybe we should go with a carpet there, or maybe we should do this thing on the ceiling, or da-da-da-da-da, blah-da-ba-rum-ba-rum-ba-rum. And usually, you know, it's always the emotional parts for when couples buy houses. It's the woman who always makes the decision. And so to me that means, but then again, I'm kind of with all the women. I mean, I love a good kitchen and a good bathroom, you know, and a good bedroom, right? But I mean, I like a good kitchen. And, if I go into a kitchen and I see that it's got, you know, 1970s tile and, you know, an old stove, but someone put a lot of money into doing a cathedral ceiling, you know, which I don't know why you would do that in the kitchen, but let's say they did that with skylights and a big chandelier hanging from 20 feet above, right? Because they thought that was cool. But they left the rest of it like, you know, a hot point stovetop, a Whirlpool dishwasher, a countertop of tile that's chipped, the grout's kind of dirty. The sink is an above sink. They might have put a new sink in, but they left the tile there, so it's riding above the tile, which is a pet peeve of mine, and no, it should be underneath. And, I've been in situations like that, you know. And the first thing I've done is strategize, okay, what can we do here to make the kitchen bigger, you know, warmer, but really cool, like all the stuff you'd want. And sometimes it involves buying things, and you know, you never know what it's going to involve. There's no formula for any house, but usually I found that if I did well with a kitchen and a bathroom or the master bathroom in some way, usually that would that would sell. One of the houses, I mean, I didn't think much of this house, but it was a famous architect that did it. And it was just a little, like, almost like a tract house, you know, very 1960s California. And I went in, and I kind of liked the everything being in one room. There was no walls going to the ceiling. There were, like, little partitions. But it's almost kind of zen in a way. So I went in there and did all the surfaces, and the biggest thing was taking the cottage cheese off these massive walls that took a long time. But then the ceilings were beautiful. And, well, anyway, landscaping and, you know, a full wood garage door that pulls back, that's made of an exotic wood, and then lacquering till it had this just mirror gloss on it. Things like that. Well, anyway, so the house sold for, when we left LA, for quite a bit of money, I thought, and I put it under the market and then got a bidding war and sold it within about 15 minutes and probably sold a little low. I found a video of it from people who were selling, and they did a terrible job. You know, they left all my changes, though. My kitchen, which in that case was a resurface of cabinets with a really, not with a wood, but with this red kind of fabric, but it was almost like a board, and then leaving the wood poles, and it really popped. And yeah, I put a granite top in it and other things, but it really popped, and not for a lot of money. It was a resurface. Love to do that. Anyway, it sold for like over $1 million in 2010, oddly enough, which of course blew my mind completely. But when I looked, it had the same bathroom that I put in there. Everything was mine. Everything I had done. And the joke is, I mean, it did have a pool and a jacuzzi, and you know, it had at one point a big deck that had a view of the San Fernando Valley from, it was just off Mulholland Drive, so that was good. You know, but gosh, that was so funny. I kept thinking of it as a tract house, you know. I mean, I really thought of it as no big deal. But I wanted to keep the flavor of the bathroom. I didn't want to do one thing gutting-wise. I just wanted to do surfaces. So, went into the... I'd done a flagstone patio, you know, overlooking the view. And there was flagstone left over, so I wanted to take this. There was this bathroom, like a 1950s or 60s bath, 1960s bathroom. Same ugly fixtures, like a cabinet in there and a countertop that you would have equated with, like, your apartment in the middle of nowhere in about 1975. So I went in with that flagstone, and I did the ceiling, the floors, and I covered the entire cabinet of the sink. I made it Flintstones. Then I took some old antique travertine small pieces, and I redid the shower, made it so there was no shower door or anything. I ripped out the shower door and made it totally Flintstone, so you could take the shower and you could spray it all over the whole bathroom because it's all stone. Ceiling, walls, floor, cabinets, you know, not the mirror, obviously, but I mean everything was like that. But the same ugly fixtures, the 1960s stuff, were there, but they were surrounded by stone, so it didn't look, you know, the faucet and the you know, the kind of almost plastic see-through knobs, but it almost became cool when you had the whole flagstone glued over everything, even the sinks. And the sinks were painted, you know, instead of replacing them, I painted them. I became a fanatic about taking what was there and redoing it, even if I had to use paint, rather than going to Home Depot or something and getting a new faucet or whatever. And now I'm not like that now. But anyway, with those old, funky, sort of Walmart fixtures and all that, by the use of stone. The stone was expensive, but I mean, I had the crew there and I had the stone there. So with those kind of changes, it sold for over $1 million. And then I think when we sold it, it was like $761,000. We had a big note on it, so we didn't really make any money on it at all because we had refinanced it twice. You remember those days? So we pretty much, after all the fees and everything, walked out with maybe, you know, enough money to kind of, you know, move out to New Mexico and start the Zeph Report. I mean, that was basically it. Had some gold, but, you know, it wasn't like we had made a... And the people that moved in, they thought we got ripped off. I'm like, how can you... But really, isn't $750,000 a lot of money? And to me, it was just ridiculous that it's something that should cost $150,000. It was going for... But it was a famous architect. It was Southern California. This guy would made a name for himself to be... He was like a Frank Lloyd Wright protege that would do the California Dream House circa 1962. And that's what he kind of became famous for in the desert and in L.A. And whatever. Why am I telling you this? Because on this remodel, it's being done, not only a remodel, but on this resurfacing of things, it's being done for the long haul because we're going to die here, one way or another. And, I mean, that's a revelation that hits you where you go, okay, so it's a little different. It's not like you're doing anything for someone else, right, or for some thinking. I was always moving into a house and doing it, thinking of who I was going to sell it to. And I, in L.A., real estate, I always squeaked by and got a profit. I always made money. You know, I was really looking back on it. It's like, geez, why didn't I just, well, the Lord had another plan. But, I mean, I didn't realize that I was a fanatic about not spending any money on new stuff, but working with what was there. It's like a thing with me. Like, you know, maybe it's because I'm like a collage artist or, you know, in music I'll do the same thing. I want to work with. And music is very similar to any kind of art, like painting, design work, you know, music, musical formation of chords and chord patterns and note patterns and things like that, and arranging them. It's all kind of comes from the same part of the brain. The same. And that reminds me, you know, the other thing that's going on is we are putting a studio in, and there'll be a guy here to help me do that today, as a matter of fact. So that's why you really haven't heard from me, because I'm just not set up yet. And the studio's gone through a transformation because I'm going into, and I'll just put this out there for you people, because I want you to know first, because it may apply to some of you. No, it's not for free, but I'll make you a good deal. But I'm going into the, you know, as well as composition and producing, I will be, you know, my main focus this next year will be setting up my music business to be doing editing and mastering. Mastering. I don't know why I'm getting into mastering, but I mean, so many bands and musicians need mastering and need editing, need sweetening, need, you know, that I'm, I'll be able to fulfill the most strict requirements of any studio, any mastering house or whatever. I will have the same capability here, but really what you're buying is ears, right? You're buying my sensibility, you're buying my ears, you're buying what I could do with to take a demo and make it, like, you know, awesome. And it's not for the result, I just really like doing it. So, and I'm busy doing an album right now that is a surprise when it comes out. You'll know about it, but it's all about praising the Lord, but in a very different way than CCM music, and I'm extremely excited about it. And but I can't proceed to the next level, you know, because I have to be able to finish off the track until that's done. But back to this sort of remodel, which the studio was like the final thing, you know, just kind of like a reset. And then living here for 7 months while there's people in the house. Literally, at one point, we were so tired that we were finally got this bed. I'd ordered this bed from China. It was like a platform bed. And I'd had my eye on these for a while, you know, and finally it was just like we'd been on almost like a cot that you put the mattress on and, you know, it hurts your back and whatnot. So this thing was the only platform that was made solid, where the top was like solid rosewood with a mahogany finish. So it was just rosewood instead of like some sort of slats that go across on a platform bed, because that's what we like. And when it came here, it was like in two pieces, and you kind of put it together pretty quickly, and it was just beautiful, and we put the mattress on top, it fit perfectly. It was like, finally, we had a spot. And it was so comfortable. You get in this bed and you just like fall asleep. So at one point we had people in the room painting trim, and you know, which and we were just both asleep. We got to the point of just being, you know, almost not walking around naked, but just, you know, it was like that where that, oh, it's okay, you wake me up when you're done. And of course, when you get to that point, you know, you're stressed out. You really are. That's at some point you have to get the place back. And then there's all the dramas about someone that, you know, cost us a lot of money because he said he was painting the outside windows. We're trying to preserve those. So we had to paint this metal trim because the inside was wood, but the outside's metal. And that's pretty tricky. And, you know, the first guys got it all over the weather stripping and you know, onto the mechanism, onto the mechanical thing that you open the window with. And I just couldn't believe it. Then finally got another guy, and then he took all the weather stripping off everything and couldn't tell where it went back. And we had to fire him, so it was two in a row. Then finally he broke a window where it wouldn't go back shut, so they had to screw it in, and I'm awaiting a window repair. I think he cost us quite a bit of money. It was demonic. It was like one guy after another on these windows, you know, destroying us with a smile on their faces. It totally demonic. It was one of the most frightening things that I've seen, you know, in the guise of helping, you know, doing harm and actually causing damage while we think we're kind of getting ahead and getting it done and, you know, being able to do what the Lord called us to do, which was sort of reset things, strengthen things, because some tough times are coming. This all leading to something too. Praise God. I pray for the safety of each and every one of you. But, you know, we can't protect you physically. Always. Not always. But the Lord will lead you into green pastures for sure. And there needn't be any fear. Amen. In Jesus' name. Then I thought, Lord, are we doing this because, you know, all this rock, the rock literally rings the entire foundation. It goes up like halfway around most of the house and then to the full roof on some of it. I mean, this is a rock. It's like a stone house. You know, it's like you see a stone house, like the stone houses of Tuscany or something. You know, they're all stone. And all the farmhouses and villas there are all stone. They start off as a wood frame and then eventually they become all stone. Or some of them start off as just rocks. We kept bringing rocks up here and more rocks up here and more rocks up here and more rocks. And, you know, finally we bought all the rocks in Santa Fe and had to go to Albuquerque because there were no more rocks. So we just had them all. So I'm going, Lord, what? And then it got to the point where after all these rocks, you know, and it's really beautiful and everything, but it fixed the foundation in a couple of places and the frame was coming loose in one spot that the rocks going right over that with the cement. It was like, what problem, you know? But Lord, what is it? Well, there's earth changes. You know, in other words, you'll need the foundation strong. And we're on bedrock here. We are on rock as far as the eye. You can't do anything. You can't even use a backhoe here. You have to use a jackhammer or dynamite. And you're not allowed to blow anything up these days. So basically, it's one or the other like that, or a big jackhammer. You cannot move the earth here. It's only rock. So why do we have to strengthen the house? Why are we going around with cement and rock over the whole thing? Because it was falling apart because of a big wind. And I got this idea that it was because of some big winds. You know, and in addition to making it beautiful and hitting the, you know, realize we're not going to, you know, we've been here for almost a decade, but then, you know, we're not going to go anywhere. So it's kind of like, I guess you push the 2.0, you know, the reset button one time, realizing that this will probably be hitting unto death. And that's a horrible way to think about things. But we know we'll be here until whatever happens. But something is going to happen. I know that's funny, selling a tract house for $1 million and then how could I wind up with very, you know, with almost no money? Well, the money I took out of LA, we went through very quickly, part of it on the Zeph report. Now I made an investment in mastering and editing, which I think is probably, you know, and composing and, you know, and you know, all the kind of work I do, I put a, you know, I have a suite together to do it, and so there'll be a shingle, there'll be a company, whatever, to do just that. Yes, won't it be funny if during the apocalypse, which I'm very much subscribed to at this point, informed of, if the apocalypse or apocalyptic events would include getting that metal band's master ready so they can submit it to Big Joe Producer in L.A. Wouldn't that be funny if on the way off the cliff, I do a couple things like that? You know, and as they're driving their van out to L.A. from getting the demo done here, you know, and it gets killer, it just sounds killer, you know. It's just like, it's better than Tool, let's say. You know, and everyone's really excited about it. They drive out there, and there's no L.A. It just basically implodes, and it's only water. I mean, imagine that. How hilarious. And I chastise the angels, because I sense that they laugh at me all the time. It's not the demonic ones who make fun of me and tease me and, you know, try to humiliate me and make me feel like a piece of, you know what. It's not that. That I can handle, but our own people, you know, are on our side, laughing like, oh, Z, you take it so seriously, like that. You know, like they already know the outcome. It's cool. And it's like, but I mean, you live and die with every second. And I'm like, yeah, you try being in flesh. You would live and die in every second too. And having amnesia and not being able to remember what, you know, what it was like before this. Knowing that you're a guy that's been, it's on the news, there's a guy that was bumped on the head and he lost all his memory. And he didn't know where he was. He was like 300 miles from home. So he just started walking in hopes that something would he would recollect something. And eventually he heard his daughter's name in a McDonald's or something. And then that woke him up to kind of where he was. And then eventually, you know, the authorities got to him and he knew to seek help. And they verified, yes, he is a missing person. He's been missing. And he'd had amnesia. And he just wandered away from wherever he was. I don't know if it was an amusement park or I don't know, something. But then he said, you know, more and more his memories came back. He was got home and, you know, he remembered his wife and, you know, he remembered his kids. And eventually his memory returned. You know, it was slow, but, it you know, he remembered a name, a glimpse. He had a fleeting memory of something that he had done. But when you talk to a guy like that, you know, that has no memory of what happened, you can tell him stuff that he'd done and you can tell him who he is, but he won't believe you. He's going to be in his predicament unless shown otherwise. So likewise, if we all have amnesia from whatever we are, because I don't believe this is present time reality at all, so, you know, maybe we're in a collective dream, some kind of thing that Yahweh has produced. If you want to call it a world and planets and all that and buy into that, that's fine. But it's not home. It's not what, you know, we remember. And so, that being the case, we have a kind of an angst. We have a feeling like, I want to go home. I want to go home. I want to know the truth. I want to know what I am. I want to know why this world, Lord. I want to know why you made this world, Lord. I want to understand why so much pain and suffering. Why does it have to be 90% pain and like 10% relief? Why is it so hard for everybody? Whether you earn a decent paycheck, whether you remodel a house and sell it for a profit like I've done, whether you're poor or broke, on your last piece of bread, you know, it's still hard. It's hard for, you know, no certainty to make a profit. The money's gone anyway. You know, the government takes theirs. The, you know, your bills suddenly, it's interesting. Whenever you have money, isn't it interesting how your bills all go up? You know what I mean? Until the money's, it's just like an automatic thing. You just end up paying more and before you know it, the burn is over and you're back where you were. you know, you rise to meet. Oh, now I can do this and this and this. Well, if you do that and that and that, unless you keep things the same, you're not going to get anywhere. And that guy Dave Ramsey will tell you that. Most people aren't anywhere. Most people are in debt. Most people are never going to get out of debt. So maybe the news of the apocalypse, which will take care of all debt, and maybe the news of the overturning of this world, which will take care of all debt, and maybe the news that you won't need food anymore, will take care of this whole idea of striving to get somewhere. You can't get anywhere. You're going to die, buddy. No matter how much you strive to suss it, to get a bank account, to anything, you're going to die and it's going to be taken away from you and it's over. And you can't, in the best circumstances, you are not going to be providing for your own security. It just doesn't work out that way. You're going to die anyway, whether it be at 60, 70, 80, whatever. You're going to die. You can't build anything here. There is no nest egg. It doesn't matter. Forget about it. You're going to die anyway. It doesn't matter. Whether you abase or whether you abound, it's equal. The fool and the wise man are equal in death. The rich man and the poor man are finally equalized in death. Both are going to die. Both are going to suffer. Both are going to lose everything. No, one's not happier than the other. One's happy in some ways, and the other's happy in other ways. And you put the two of them together, and probably it balances out. But it doesn't really matter. The suffering will be over upon death. The memory of the suffering will be over, because every tear, it says in the book of Revelation, Revelation 20, every tear, every eye will be dried. Tears will be dried. Memories, meaning, what the Bible mean by that? Memories will be afresh. You won't remember this. You won't have trauma in your new body over this. The new body is nothing new. You already have this body. You already exist in this body. It's not going to be created. It's not like you're going to transform from this to that. You already are that, but we're here, and it's the most... Look, many people have tried to describe this, the people that did The Matrix, that, you know, they've tried to describe it, the Bible, that there've been all kinds of teachers trying to explain this to you, but I don't think anyone is... Because where I've gone, the teachers would call me a blasphemer at this point, because I'm telling you already exist in eternity. And my axiom and my implacable, inarguable point and my infallible point, which can't be argued by even by God, not that he would do it because he's the one that gave it to me. But, you know, that's who you'd have to take it to argue it. Nothing enters into eternity. It's either eternal or it's not. Would you agree with me on that? Therefore, you exist. I rest my case, Your Honor. There is no other way to look at it. Let the paradoxes float, baby. Come on, let them be there. Just accept that you can't figure it out and let it just kind of ride along shotgun. One day you will. You got something weird in a box. You know, you're driving along the desert. You got this old Carmen Ghia convertible. You got this weird box sitting next to you. You know what I'm saying? Wind's blowing in your hair. You don't know where you're going. You're young. Let's say you're 25 years old. You know, you're on your way to something exciting. You got this mystery box next to you and you don't know what it is. You're dying to find out, but you keep, no matter how you've tried to pry it open, throw rocks at it, sit there and consider it, think about it, you can't open it. You're just kind of stuck with it, riding shotgun. The only thing is you think you're going somewhere as you're driving across that beautiful desert. The desert has its mysteries, doesn't it? It's got its beauty, but don't look too long or you get burned, right? Those of you desert people, don't like it too much or you get burned. Yep. Anyway, there you're going across the desert and you got this mystery thing. And then you realize, pretty soon you realize, hey, wait a second. My gas needle isn't going down. There is no gas station in sight anyway. I don't seem to be hungry, but there is no restaurant or diner anywhere on this road. I'm driving down this endless road, endlessly, and in perpetual motion, for what? What is that? It's like I arrived in a Dali painting. What is this? And that's what I'm talking about. There is no way he can figure that out. It's like the Twilight Zone. He can't figure that out. All he knows is that he's got this mystery box next to him. He's driving on an endless desert, and he has endless gasoline and endless energy and no hunger and no fatigue, and there are no restaurants and no help and no other people in sight. The sun stays in the same place in the sky that it was 10, 20, 50, 50 minutes ago. And so there he is. There he is, a living, breathing paradox with no clue, because if he didn't have amnesia, he might be able to do something about his situation. But he does have amnesia because he doesn't know who he is. And he thinks maybe there's something in the box that will inform him of just at least give him some... No, all his needs are met. He's not hungry, he's not tired, he's not old. He's handsome. Compared to what, though, right? His car is full of gas. It's a classic car he really loves. All is right with the world, you might say. Okay? Now, that state I'm describing, and there's a reason I'm telling you this story, is the perfect state that everyone strives for. When people pass 25, 30, their glory days, they keep wanting to recreate the best time of their glory days at some future time. Like, once they get this and once they get that, once they do their house, once they put in that swimming pool, once they, get the right job or the right bar to go to, once they, whatever. Everyone's trying to recreate their glory days of say, high school and college, or their early 20s when they just were kind of reckless abandon. They're trying to recreate that feeling. They keep putting on that Journey song, Don't Stop Believing, right? Over and over with Steve Perry, the great vocal of the 80s. They keep hitting replay, replay, replay. And it's just not working out. Something's really just not right here. I want to know. I'm in this little loop, this dream, everything. I have the perfect day in mind. And I keep trying to create it, one number, what house I buy, over the hearth, I put my famous football. I put that, or basketball, or baseball that was signed by, whatever. And I'm not going to mention any names because I don't want to tag this into reality too much. But I mean, I've got my thing out there. I got my car in the garage. I got this wife and 2.5 kids, and they've gone off and gone to college, and everything's fine with that. And we all have these kind of jobs, and I go, I don't really know what I do. I go and I push around the paper and I analyze things and I put in a report, but I don't know where it goes. Then they pay me and then I pay my mortgage, and then we have our, but I don't know what that is. And it's like, dude, that's the same thing I just described. The guy's driving along in that car, his needs are met, but there's no people, you look at your wife, you look at your kids, and suddenly, like the Talking Heads song, you don't know who they are. You don't understand. Why do we form these relationship with these things and build these houses like this? I mean, I ask myself, why do I have to have the sink over there? You know what I mean? If I could do, I could have done anything I wanted to in this kitchen, because the kitchen had to, the cabinets were falling apart and everything, so we had to replace all that. So I could have rearranged. No, I went back. I wanted to be what was here because I really liked it. So it just became a replacement. But why is the stove over there? Why is this oven over here on the left, this oven? Why is that refrigerator built into the wall like that? Why do we have cabinets that look like... What is the point? And the whole point, I find out, is we keep trying to recreate that feeling of that time that we can't explain to ourselves, because it if we did achieve it, it would bug us even more than trying to achieve it. And so, where the hearth might have been, and that we have a big room here, like a living room, but we call it the great room. It's a little house. It's a couple house for two people. It's not for kids or anything. It was built like as a retirement, place. This couple is going to retire. Their kids are grown, and my kid's grown, and it's just easy, kind of all an open floor plan, and it's no big deal. It's really no big deal. It's pretty. Normal, and it's not, you know, there's no neighborhood here. It's hidden in a way from the road, and nobody sees it. And it's, anyway, but we like it, and it, we can maintain it in our old age, which is important. Now, I'm not saying I'm old now, but, you know, there's a time where it's hard to get up and down the stairs, and, you know, hard to get down the hall, and hard to get in the bed, and hard to have a bath, and hard to do stuff, you know, should we live that long. And anyway, so in the great room, there's like an area where there is a fireplace, and what we did with that is years ago we put a stove heater there that's a wood stove, heating stove, on the hearth of the fireplace, and did a conversion so the actual hearth area would hold the stove. It was just more practical. So if you feed the stove these logs, it gets up to like 1,200 degrees. 1,500 degrees, and it will heat the whole house, because we were just tired of throwing logs on the fire to have it be there and then be heating the outside. So this actually was, they had a point to it, so we made a conversion there. But that's not really where the fireplace should have been. It was kind of, you know, if you take the room and it's rectangular and oblong, you take the oblong wall, the long wall, and put it there in between windows. There's another place where there's a shorter wall. It looks like there should be a hearth there. And there is a hearth, and they built it in an indentation and everything for a television. So the hearth is really the TV, and it sits recessed in there, you know. It looks pretty good. You know, it's got its area that it's not just, you know, put on the wall. It's got a recessed kind of indentation area for a big screen, and that's what's there. But it's funny how it reminds you of a hearth. You know, you put your cross on there, your sacred objects, and then here's this TV, which then, what's the point of the TV? The TV programs you to keep remembering that perfect day of your glory days, and that's what all TV programs do. All commercials and all TV programs are trying to help you do what you want to do in your heart, which is recapture that perfect day that has gone from you. And all of humanity, when they build their houses, when they build their hearths, which is also, by the way, the sacred part of the room, which would be for the most reverence. And they build their hearth, and they build their kitchens, and they build their bathrooms. They're all trying to find that feeling again. So they figure if they do more and better and get the best architect, the best this and the best designer and the best everything, they can somehow recreate it. And even the wealthiest people, like, say, out in Malibu, people like Cher and other people like that, they spend $20 million getting the property, then they put another $20 million or $100 million into fixing it up, you know, buying the right painting and getting the right this and that. And then you read about their divorces and their miserableness, because everyone, rich or poor, in sickness or vibrant health, still what keeps us alive is this searching for that perfect day, for that thing that we don't have but we know is there. And we build our houses, and we go have our careers, and we work, and we do this, we do that. Everything we do is designed to find that. We go consume. We go to Target and Walmart, and we go on vacations. And all of this is, we go to the gym to try to get that weight off. And, you know, we go get those facelifts and do things and wear jewelry and get the right clothing. All of this is designed to try to capture that one thing of, what does it mean to be alive? Well, it means searching for that thing that you lost. Is what it means. It means a guy just going on the road and walking to trying to find out who he is, because he doesn't know, because he hit his head. All of humanity is caught up in that very same thing. And then the fighting comes about when forces want to control you, like the governments, the television, social pressure to conform, and all that puts pressure on you. And conforming, here's what conforming is. Conforming means turning your mind off, stopping asking any questions, putting your tent stakes down and saying, I'm not going to think about that anymore. Let's get on with our shindig. Sorry. That's why the angels are laughing at me, because I will never do that. That life is just too precious to just give up and say, oh, this is good enough for me. I'm not going to think, and I'm just going to be, as Jackson Brown said in the Pretender, I'm going to be a happy idiot struggling for the legal tender. And he defined himself. No, not beautiful folk songs that he would write, and it's got nothing to do with it. He wants to be a happy idiot struggling for the legal tender, knowing that he had to bow down to Satan to get that job in the first place, so therefore he's a pretender. And that's what he's writing about. He went ahead and gave up. He tried to fight them and fight the man and fight the world and fight it all, and then he just gave in. So now he's the great pretender. Well, before that event ever happened, that's basically what I call man-made Satan. You know, where man requires conformity to let you into the club. That's man-made. I'm sorry, that's not anything exotic. That's man-made Satan. That's man as Satan. That's the most pathetic thing there is on earth. You get through our initiation process, you too can wear a fez. You know what I mean? It's ridiculous. Now you don't have to think. You got your fez. Got your fez on. Oh, there it is. Nothing left to think about. You've already defined it. That's nirvana, baby. The world never was good enough for me. You know, I was always one of these people that, you know, call me a malcontent, I guess, but I'm not really a malcontent. I really am a happy person, too, though. That's the thing. But I couldn't stop thinking. And then, of course, when the whole satanic thing came in the 60s and 70s of my life, I absolutely rejected that. I couldn't believe that any of my friends were doing it. And they would show up in their Porsches and their Ferraris, and they'd say, come on, this is working pretty good for me. Remember, They Live, when all those homeless guys were suddenly in tuxedos and rich, remember that in the end? And they go, working pretty, you know, nodding and winking to each other. That is exactly. So, like, this is high school, but they're looking at me going, ah, look what I got going on. You can have it too, you know, it's no big deal. Things are a lot better now. And I'd look at them with envy, really. But I'd go like, you know, but wow, what does that mean? I mean, you know, these people kill people. I mean, they have mayhem. And I guess the kids at that age didn't realize, when they discovered this brand new way to live, that there was murder involved. Which was my beef with the churches. Yeah, my beef was that, you know, when you conform and you put you're signing on with murder. See, that's the, you know, lying, cheating, but I mean the ultimate one is murder, and also the loss of human rights, the loss of the ability of free speech. So, I don't know. I guess if your God is money. The funny thing is, I've had money on and off throughout my life, and never really, you know, maybe it was just the circumstances of my birth or whatever, but I mean, even in the most amazing circumstances, something would happen, and, you know, and I look at it now like the Lord's provided. So I never had that motivation, like, if you don't do this with Satan, you're going to be broken, dying, and destitute, and going down. And I never saw that. Furthermore, I read Psalm 37. And it said that he'd never seen, like, the children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren begging for bread of a believer in Yahweh and a believer of the truth, the life and the way. No, Jesus is the provider. And then I later came to understand that. So I went to the church and said, hey, guys, Jesus is the provider. So, you know, you can knock that crap off. Jesus, see, you're already there. We have Bible study and we come and we sing songs. So we just got a little further to go. Just, you know, let Jesus provide instead of, get out of here, you asshole. Get that F out. Okay, I just want to tell you guys. Okay, I'm sorry. Yeah, you just sit down and shut up. In a couple of years, maybe you can speak. I thought you were supposed to be nice here. You know? You're a fool! Well, why so vehement? I mean, it looks to me like you want to kill me. I do. It's not me, Brosy. It's what's in me that wants to kill you. Yeah, but I thought you said you're a Christian pastor. And that's why people get mad at me. That very thing that I just did will get me in a lot of trouble today. I'm almost assured of things going wrong because that's the kind of thing. And I'm just in a rut. You know, I can't seem to stop with that understanding since, you know, childhood. I just don't seem to be able to turn the corner and go, okay, I'm down, baby. Let's go. Let's take off on that joyride. You can have that time of your glory days. Just come on in. I can? Are you sure? Well, don't look over there in that corner with the blood splattered all over the wall. Don't worry about that. It's okay. We've got a little job for you. You could be a shoe salesman and no one will bother you. Guarantee that all the women that come in, none of them are going to start complaining to you or telling them their life stories or all the latest gossip, so you'll be left alone while they bully you into submission, you idiot. I offer no solution to that situation that was just described in a highly dramatic way, you say. I'm leading up to something I was going to tell you. So I had this dream. The last two nights, you know, like my mother was in the dream. And I hadn't seen her in a dream since her death, you know. And even before that, I hadn't seen her for, you know, maybe never. I mean, maybe, you know, maybe briefly here and there. But, and then she would turn into an animal. And then there was the next door neighbor. And then they turned into a cat. And I was petting the cat. And then, but it had this, like, overarching feeling that we were kind of in a, like something had happened and we weren't in the same world anymore, like maybe we left this world. And then that's all, and that was like one. And then last night, and I didn't think much of it, I just kind of, and last night it was a little more clear. So now looking back on it, I can tell you I was in a place, and I'm only remembering a part of it, but went something like this. There were people that are after us, you know, same war, you know, the Nazis and the conformists and the nonconformists all fighting it out. And, you know, same thing, chasing around the, you know, running around the track, one chasing the other, you know, deciding that, you know, he wants to control that guy, so he wants to make him conform, so he's chasing him with a billy club. And this is a dream I've had over and over again. They lure you into a house that you can't get, you come in but you can't get out, and they're behind every door trying to get you because you won't agree with them or whatever. You know, there's that kind of satanic dream or satanic attack in a dream, which can be just rebuked. And although that's a microcosm of the way it really is, and especially the way Johnny Kleck explains it, when people, the whole room can suddenly turn and all start talking in a different voice and looking at you and zeroing in on you, and the whole atmosphere can change. We've seen that kind of thing too, like a nightmare in real time, in a real place, but you can make an argument that, well, that wasn't a real place. We were taken somewhere and that event happened and then put back somehow. Huge sci-fi stuff, sci-fi type of stuff. Anyway, this one was a little different. In that, someone like me, or someone like you, maybe, you know, you're not going to suddenly have, see, I kind of have to have a split thing going on, because I have a lot of friends who are part of the system, and they're very good people, and they mean well, and they want to help and everything else, and, you know, sometimes I'm like a good friend and they really love me, and other times they want to run me through with a sword. And it's like that with all of them, because they know they want me around. They really want to know God and want me to help them and want to pray with me and all that. And they want to help, you know, but then they don't want to leave where they are. And then they turn on you because then they don't want to see you, and then they want to love you and see you again. You know what I mean? And it's kind of like this. It's not got anything to do with me or you or people like who are really sold out to the Lord. It's has to do with their own inner process. They're trying to come. I mean, every single one, every single human being that signs on with Satan or conforms to the whatever is regretful and wants a way back and believes that by going to church, that that's the way, the offered way back. What they didn't understand was that their free will wasn't given to Jesus, it was given to the devil, and Jesus is still awaiting for them to give him the free will, in other words, to trust him. And so they have this tortured, they're in a tortured pickle, and sometimes, you know, they get frustrated and strike out, and they might kill you, you know. And then other times they really want you. You know what I mean? And it kind of goes like that, dances around. It's not ever going to be at peace for a person until they finally decide, okay, and for the person that is sold out to Jesus, then what really bugs you is, yeah, but you sin. You slander. You lie. You do awful things. You lust. You get drunk. You hate on people. Huh? Oh, you're envious, are you? You're jealous of that younger one, huh? Jealous of that richer one, huh? That talented one, huh? You just want to kill him, take what he has, what he's earned, because you couldn't earn it yourself, so you want to get the government to go commie and take it away from him. Yeah! Yeah. But you say you're sold out to Jesus. How are you any better than the guy over here who's done 10 times of charity work? He's 10 times more clear-headed. Been a provider for his family. He doesn't just when he drinks every time he gets drunk. He has 2.3 drinks, and that's it, perfectly. He never makes a mistake there. And he's more fit for God. You're a mess. Why do you think God has you and not him? You got it backwards. He goes to church, well-respected in the community. He became president of the United States. He loves hunting and loves his friends. Now, you're right. I am a mess. I'm a total mess. And I don't have any right to judge anybody. I know that. I was just pointing at, yeah, well, you can also have your head cut off right now. Yeah, but wait a sec. Before you talk like that, you were a nice person, remember? And so the prophets get killed by the good people, then enshrined on the wall and worshipped as the great prophets of old. And Jesus is crucified by the good people who later enshrine him and even make an image of him that they can bow down to when they laughed and scourged and whipped and beat him to a bloody pulp, unrecognizable. And then crucified him and then enshrined him as a hero. Or Braveheart with Mel Gibson. How long do you think after that movie ended there was a statue of old William Wallace? And they would pay reverence to the statue of such a great man. And who killed Braveheart? The good people of the community. Because he wouldn't bow down, he wouldn't conform. So they drew and they had him drawn and quartered because he wouldn't renounce the call for freedom. He wouldn't bow down to the king. It doesn't matter what form it takes. It's still the same exact scenario of bowing down versus freedom. Conformity equals slavery versus freedom. Jackson Brown wrote a song. I think it's one of the most brilliant songs I've ever heard, by the way. Is it The Great Pretender or is it The Pretender? Maybe it's The Pretender. Okay, well, the lyrics of that song are just awesome. And that was a very talented young man when he did that. And what's so interesting is he had it so right on the situation in the world. I mean, he nailed it. You know, the young and strong lads fighting back, fighting the world, fighting for what's right, being idealistic, fighting for freedom, only to surrender, the lyric goes. And isn't that the truth? And then I come in and say, okay, but here's hope, Jesus. I already got Jesus. I'm covered. And then, oh, but wait, okay, I'm sorry I brought it up. But when someone else brings it up, Brother Z, why don't you accept Jesus? And, you know, me, gosh, now I'm getting confused. I thought I had accepted Jesus. Well, not really. So want me to accept Jesus. And what do I have to do? How do I accept Jesus for you? What would be good enough proof for you to say that you're one of us? Am I just beating the point too much? I'm sorry. But isn't that the way it goes? Isn't it awful? It's so hard, isn't it? It's so hard. And then there's the other option of just jump in and be happy and be a happy idiot, start going for the legal tender and stop thinking, you idiot. Stop thinking. And that's what I was doing. Stop making collages with political figures in it. And, you know, now if I make a collage, I'd have like FEMA camps and, you know, and it's going to come down to blood. Okay, wait. Let me explain this. This entire thing we're talking about and beating around the bush and dramatizing and having some fun with, it's going to come down to, you know, a big major war with blood and tanks and concentration camps. Oh, yeah. Well, no worries. Your local church will be giving out the mark of the beast. Then they'll have a gun confiscation. That'll be where you bring your extra food because no one's allowed to hoard. You can bring your guns in and you get a microchip on top of it. Okay? The churches will be very helpful in that day. And it comes right into your living room. You know, you want to at least, would you just leave us alone in the living room? Can I just be free in my living room? Can I just watch my TV and just forget about everything and will you quit bothering me? Oh no, no, we're coming into the living room. First with programming through your TV. And then eventually we're going to have to inspect your carbon footprint. So when you say conform, at what level do you finally say enough is enough? Right? When you bow down, at what point do you say, okay, enough is enough? At some point, you want to assert your individuality, your personhood, your beingness, your creation as existing. Now, I'm valid, I exist, which will be the point you get killed. How's that for a harsh world? I mean, that very thing that I'm talking about is being put in place by the color of law, Homeland Security, FEMA, all these things. And I know people who work for FEMA. Yeah. Not just one person, I know a couple people. And now they don't know each other, but nicest people you'd ever want to meet. Seriously. There's another component to this. And that is there's a lot of good people that are unaware of where this is all going. And they're doing their jobs in the compartmentalized fashion. They mean no harm on anyone. And then I'm the, unfortunate one who is having to spout out this warning. And I don't know even if I can make it through this. I mean, would you really get mad at me if I put on a brown shirt or an SS sticker? Would you really be mad at me if I failed? If I inadvertently bowed down because I'm just tired of it, look, folks, I can't take it anymore. You know what I mean? I've been kind of pushed it alone. I mean, I want to go to church and worship Jesus. So I'm going to bow down and take the deal and get it over with and get on with it. And then I'm going to report on my neighbors. And to move up the ladder, I also will be distributing the chip and operating the guillotines. No problem. Anyone asserting any individuality, I'll spy on them on Facebook and on Twitter. I'll keep a list of them for Roundup Day. See, ultimately, the requirement for conformity will be that I just mentioned. At what point are you going to say no? It's no longer going to be hidden out of sight where you had a silent nod and wink and it's okay because no one's going to know, you know. No, everyone's going to know who you are and who you are not. Everyone. In the light of the whole world, that's the goal, to stand up and proudly proclaim the devil or the Lord. And nobody seems to be able to get away from this impending event that seems to be just like having a birthday or a graduation, or it seems that this is, and none of us knows if we're really going to be ready on that day. But I dare say, those who had sold out as teenagers, well, how do you feel about it now? I mean, now they were going to ask you to do a lot more evil stuff to maintain your status. At what point do you say enough is enough? Jesus, help me. I already got Jesus. I don't need to say that. Okay. Never mind. I get so frustrated with this. I really feel like I came here from outer space and I just arrived and I can't even believe it, you know. I feel like I'm a walk-in, you know. Like I walked into this body, that this poor guy that had this body committed suicide, or, you know, and then I, right before they pulled the plug, I stepped in and he was revived, and that's me. You know? Sometimes I feel like that. Because I feel so different that I feel like, you know, it's like, you know, we're all the same, brothers. I'm like, okay, fine. Fine. We're all the same. Everything's everything, baby. It's all identical. Well, that's what Barack Obama and Janet Napolitano and everyone would like you to think. We are all the same and we all deserve the same outcome, yeah? That's what communism's all about. Death of the individual and the rise of the collective. Everyone gets a piece of the pie. It's fair now. You're all in poverty and you're all in a totalitarian state and none of you have freedom, so it's equal. I've tried to warn about that. Communism is Satanism, period. The Democrat Party is communist, period. There is no other way to look. They are communists. Yeah. The Republican Party rhinos are also communists. People don't like that word because it makes you sound like a freak, but that's what they are. And first they had to be Satanists. They had to have bowed down to the pop culture, you know, to be somebody, to be Madonna, to be, you know, a celebrity, to be whatever. They bowed down and then they became communists. It goes hand in hand. In exchange for your fame and fortune, I want your allegiance to the Communist Party, but we'll call it Democrat. Okay, that's why they can be really rich and vote for huge tax increases, because they owe the whole thing to the daddy behind the scenes of the deal, to the Wizard of Oz. They owe, so they have to do. It's not about making sense. It's about bowing down to, you know, dancing with the one who brung you. And that's why they give money to all the left-wing causes that want to tax everyone to death and create no freedom, because they wouldn't be celebrities unless they had gotten their benefit from them to begin with. That's why they do it. There is no other reason, and this argument cannot be broken. For any reason, it's not about conscience or let's help the poor. They don't help the poor. It's about celebrity in exchange for obedience, period. Slavery.
But they get to fly around on planes, Brother Z, and they get to, you know, fly into like, you know, in these concerts and go off on these Caribbean cruises on their private yachts, and they get to, you know, well, yeah, for a while. Until the bloom is off the rose, anyway. And lead it, you know, lapse into obscurity in old age. Look, it doesn't really matter. You all have the same choice. There are people that, you know, had signed on for, you know, to be any kind of job, any kind of... And only too quickly understood while they sat in their hypocritical churches realizing that they're sinking lower and lower every day. They're not getting anywhere. No matter how much you sit at the bar and drink, you ever got that point where you just can't get drunk anymore? You just drink and drink. No matter how much you drink, you can't get drunk. You can't find relief. You just feel lousy. And then, bro, don't forget, it's the other guy's fault. So we have a war. We create some horrible situation like using... You know, advanced technology to create a drought. They say they can create rain. So if they can create rain, why don't they just go ahead and create rain on the drought? Because they created the drought. So they can have a big emergency so Obama can come in and save it. Or chemtrails or whatever. All of this is part and parcel of bowing down. If you sign on for one thing, you're a murderer on the other hand, period. And I don't think you can live with that going into death. When the Lord tells you, why did you kill my people? No, I believe in you, Lord. Enough said. Is there ever enough said on this? Can anyone in the world articulate it better? I don't think so. With all due respect. The reason I don't think so is because I've never heard it. It's quite possible that there is a broadcast professional out there who has the gift of speaking and thinking at the same time, who is able to, you know, get at the nub of this thing. But usually, every talk show host I hear, or religious speaker, or whatever you want to say, philosopher, whatever, beats around the bush. We don't really ever get into mentioning the problem because that would be egregious to some people and it would hurt their feelings, so we just don't do it. It's inconvenient as hell. I don't want to lose my juju, man. I'm not choosing a fight with the hounds of hell. I don't want the wrath of the pretty little people to come upon me. Capisce? My daughter laughs at me when I try to do Italian. Now, that having been said, I'm all for a good day work for a good day pay. I'm all for... Your yes is yes, your no is no. Huh? But it just didn't work out that way. Paul Simon said in the his song. What was that song? Okay, I can't remember. The Mother and Child Reunion, remember? He actually mixed that in the studio that Jimmy Cliff down in Jamaica, I believe. He was a big hit in the 70s, about 1970. And, you know, I guess he was just talking about a certain form of bowing down, perhaps, saying, you know, in the end, it just doesn't work out that way. In other words, you can't just stay the straight and narrow course. It just doesn't work out that way. Over the course of a lifetime, you're going to have to bow down over and over again. Whatever that means to you, okay? I'm not going to define it. You could get very tawdry language on that, or you could get, you know, very horrific language on that, but I'm not going to define it, because you could just imagine what all that entails, bowing down. We seem to love, as a society, that rebel who lets his hair down and just kind of, like, you know, pukes all over the stage. I'm thinking Marilyn Manson, right? We seem to love that, right? Sex, drugs, rock and roll, everything backwards, a satanic glee, invincible on that stage, huge music, huge metal sound, and all the kids saying, yeah, I want to go to hell. Yeah, I want to go to hell. Yeah, I love death, and I love hate, and I hate love. Yeah, baby. We seem to love that. We seem to just love that. Well, you should see the guy now. I forgot his name. Who cares? He's a loser now. He's pathetic. But, I mean, you know, it's sad. He wrote F-U, you know, F-U, you know, spell it out. In case Frankie wants to run this one. F-U on his face, spelled out, you know. You know, on his face. At the LAX airport. And, you know, the big rebel, you know, wow. And on this middle-aged guy, it really is pathetic. I mean, it's sad that he's like this sad clown now, you know, this parody of himself. And then he started, like, trying to hide that from the kids and the mothers of the kids. So it's like, well, what happened to this big rebel with no conscience? He could do anything he wants. You know, well, no, kids and parents wouldn't stop him back then. So he's trying to hide it. He's just trying, in other words, he's being forgotten. He wanted to do something bad so that someone will remember him and maybe help him or something. Well, he's got plenty of money. You know, he always will. But, you know, I guess what comes to mind is, was that worth it? Was it worth it being, you know, a clown slave, I suppose, only to be thrown into the dustbin of history along with everybody else for the rest of your life, being a parody of yourself and a sad clown and no musical prowess whatsoever? I mean, nobody cares. It was about youth, and he lost his youth, and everyone does. It's nothing that he did. It's just that's what happened. He put all his energy in that. And his message was, serve Satan, serve hatred, conform, yes, to sex, drugs, rock and roll, and the slave system of the world of selling your soul in exchange for whatever. And hate your parents, and hate your society, and hate everything, and it's cool, and scar yourself up, and burn yourself, and tat yourself out, and self-destruct. Tell everyone to F off. The doctrines of devils. And now wonders why his life is hard. Well, I mean, I just saw a picture, and on the picture I could read the picture. It seemed like his life is hard. Maybe it's easy. Maybe he's floating downstream. I don't know. You're all going to die. It's just, now we're in God's waiting room, making decisions on how we're going to handle our death. That's the whole thing on earth. We come to earth to die. And how we handle it is up to each one of us, but that's basically what we're here doing, is dying. Some people think if they conform to, you know, take Satan's offer, that they will really have a great life. No, there is no life. It's just death, and we're trying to live, and that's why we need Jesus. But to do that, we end up renouncing the world because it's his way or the highway, and the world's way is not his way, so that's the way it is. Every one of those Olympic medalists, you know, they'll be looking back. Those were the glory days. In a way, the Olympics celebrates death. The death of a dream. You know, they do the Olympics and now it's over. It died. They'll revive it again in 4 years. The people there died too. Their medals are over and whatever. they can go help people live a nicer life. No, you help people to have a nicer death. That's really what's going on upon the earth. God's waiting room. Or if you like, we're born on death row. We're doing our time. And while we're here doing our time, we're deciding how we're going to die. Those who tried to live and be something are disappointed with the idea that, you know what, it's over and it's bad in the past and it doesn't matter anymore and it's all about death. They don't want it to be about that. So they'll put out of their mind anything that reminds them of that, keep watching the TV and keep doing the programming, try to recapture that glory day moment when they won the gold medal, and they want to keep trying to recreate that in houses, clothing, daughters, sons, trips, vacations, politics, science, research, everything to try to recreate that moment that will never be again because it's sadly gone, it's dead. The smart people realize you come here to die. Anything you do in the meantime is irrelevant. I mean, you know, let me rock that back a little bit. Not irrelevant. I mean, Marilyn Manson figured out that just doing whatever he wanted to do on stage and tearing it up and being an evangel for Satan, in other words, do what thou wilt, an evangel for, hatred and lust and perversion and blah, 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 child abuse, whatever. He became and people said, oh, that's real freedom. So that's what he decided to do with his time. Mother Teresa decided to help the poor. Okay, so we all can do different things while we're here, but basically none of those things matter in the end unless we ourselves have gotten to the point of decision one way or the other, God or the devil. You know, that decision needs to be made before one helps the poor, before one builds a castle, before one decides to be a Satanist punk. I mean, at some point, which in this guy, Brian, I keep forgetting, Brian Warner, is that his name? The Alice in Wonderland guy? Marilyn Manson, Brian Warner. Well, in his case, you know, people thought that was real freedom. Now he's riding FU on his face, walking through LAX, and blinking, i.e. he's hiding that from kids. That was a telltale thing in the article I read. He was hiding that from kids and apologizing. Well, that doesn't sound like that big bad Satanist to me, does to you? That old guy, he would have got himself arrested. No, they Homeland Security or whatever, the TSA, they wouldn't lay a hand on him. But believe me, if you put that on your face, you'd be locked up. They wouldn't lay a hand on him. So the world's a dream world. There really is no law here. There is no politics. There is no nation. There is nothing. It's just a waiting room. You know? And we endlessly create, you know, these hoops for each other to jump through, to conform to, to vet people when, you know, we're just in on death row. I mean, what does it matter at that point? No, because we want to recreate that perfect time. And to do that, we're going to have to win. So to win, we got to cheat. To cheat, we got to take Satan, not tell anyone, and hope that gives us a boost to get in. Now, what if everybody did that? What if everybody did that, took that shortcut? What if everyone did that, thinking they were going to live forever, thinking that they're, hey, how about this one, thinking that their puny little life really matters, thinking that, boy, they're important. Compared to what? Compared to who? Compared to what event on here is important? War, so what? Olympics, so what? It's here, I watch it, it was here, then it was gone. So I say, well, what did it really even happen? I can't prove it. I can make a case that there was no Olympics. It was just, you know, did we really go to the moon? No, we never went to the moon and we never had the Olympics. Or we went to the moon and we had the Olympics, but in the end, does that really even matter? We're still in the waiting room of death. Brian Warner, if that's, I can't, if, someone will correct me. You know, he's still going to get old and look, you know, like a sad clown and try to do publicity stunts to try to get back where it was in his glory day. He was probably a nerd in high school, and this was his vengeance, being a, you know, putting on that persona and being a big, bad, satanic monster. He was going to get even with all those kids that teased him. I don't know. Who knows what people's motivations is, but it all goes back to that, about that time in life. And isn't it sad that we continue to go round and round and round? And there are people I know that actually take issue, who say, well, like, if you're connected to the Lord, you wouldn't be connected to the world. But what they're trying to do is get under the color of law, you to be a criminal because you're connected to the Lord, not the world, meaning, oh, not, no, you might shoot up a parking lot or whatever. Even though you're the most peaceful person there is, the most loving person there is, even though you love people, it doesn't matter. It's going to come down to, will you renounce your faith? Will you then agree with us? Okay? And agreeing with us means, you know, nodding and winking today. Tomorrow it means putting on a brown shirt. The next day it means becoming an executioner. The next day it means doing things you never thought you would do to keep in the game. The next day you realize you're a slave, but what does it matter? You can't fight City Hall. And I'm here to tell you, it doesn't matter. You think you're in a game. You think you're fighting City Hall. You're not. It's all an illusion, friend. There is no City Hall. There is no game. You, like me, are in this waiting room to die. And what you do between now and then really is almost irrelevant compared to who you are in your heart, and what you decide to be, and whom you decide to serve is more important than what you do. What you do doesn't really matter. And I know I'm all caught up with the politics. I mean, I'm really behind, as you would predict, I'm behind Romney and Ryan, both of whom would probably hate me after hearing this. But see, I don't hold a grudge. I have no vendetta against anyone or against any abuse that I perceived had happened to me. I have no vendetta, nothing. I forgive all. We step on each other's toes, and I hope you forgive me too. We step on each other's toes every day. In my case, you know, I was like pressured to be something I wasn't. And, you know, they basically said, well, you're going to be something, you're going to, you know, be this or you're going to die. You know, we don't want you. Okay, fine. We'll see. We'll see who wins. They wanted me to be, to apply my prodigious intellect to being a lawyer. That's right, preferably with an MBA, not a creative type, not an artist, especially not a poet like I've been all my life. I mean, don't be that. You know, with a deep thought, with, you know, talking, I was talking about stuff like this when I was 17, trying to explain my case to the psychiatrist, you know, and to the police, to anyone who would listen. To my teachers. And predictably, they didn't want to hear anything about it. They did. They wanted nothing to do with any kind of logic that would get to the point of calling all this some sort of grand illusion. And they, you know, and I know fellow musicians, and I swear they, look, brother, it's not me you hate. You just don't want to be woken up. You thought you found love, but you found hate. You thought you found peace, but you suffered. But then you double down on it. You're trying to figure out the world from the perspective of, not from the Word of God and not from the perspective of the Holy Spirit. And to you, if you could just, if only, if they would, then we could be happy. And the truth is, you'll never be happy, because all of us, every single, I'll tell you, we're the same in this regard. Every human being is trying to recreate that moment where they felt that bliss. And all of us fail. You know, no sooner do I put in replace my crumbling tile floor with a nice slate rock floor, that I see the sealer needs to be resealed again. And some of the edges crumble, and it's never going to be able to do anything here. I can shore it up, but one day it crumbles again. Shore it up on my way to my grave. It's not nihilism. I'm saying that the only place I know where I don't have that problem is in Christ. The only place I know there's happiness is when my soul is happy, meaning not worried about death. To me, that's happiness. Not worried about what somebody else is going to do or not do, or the news, or the politics, Trish. I don't find happiness in politics at all. I find it's very frustrating. It's easier to be in it and of it than in it and not of it. Not just Jesus was persecuted, but his disciples, the apostles, and the church also. You can see that every time there's some wacko out there, usually a programmed psyop, killing people at random, they try to blame that he must be a right-wing Christian. How can that happen? People would actually lie and go against the evidence because they're just so wanting, because of the spirit that's in them. They just want to persecute people that they perceive are more free than they are, or are not thinking the right thoughts, or whatever it is. We all have the same thought. We're all trying to recreate that happiness that we had. But I contend that it's not when you were a child. That's just an illusion. That's a deception. You're trying to create the happiness that you had before this, I contend. And you're trying to recreate the happiness that you had after this. So, Bro Z, what are you saying? I'm saying that you're here so you can die. What is it going to take for you to die? Meaning, be at peace. Is there a single act you can do of feeding the poor, feeding the hungry, taking care of the poor, any kind of charitable act that will make you be at peace? Well, some people find that, they get a relative peace, but no, there is no act that you can do, good or bad, selfish or unselfish, that makes any difference whatsoever. It makes a difference in people's lives, and you can have a sense of fulfillment. I'm saying it's better to be charitable and better to be selfless rather than selfish. Sure, selfishness leads to pain and suffering. Attachment to this world leads to pain and suffering. Seeking that which you had but lost in your youth leads to pain and suffering. I'm reminded of those hideous pictures of people that went too far with plastic surgery. So their faces become monstrous. You've seen those online. Then they were just trying to find happiness. And in so doing, they became monstrous. The picture of Dorian Gray is another great example. He signed on with the devil to be young, to recreate that beautiful time. Became the most miserable person on earth. Rock and roll, all you got to do is look at a series called Where Are They Now on YouTube. If you can stand it. I can't. I already know. Only when I am still and know that He is God and I'm His kid and we're one John 17. And I rely on that John 17 a lot. Do I find peace? And peace to what? What's peace to me? Peace is when I can die right now and be at peace with it. Now that's leading me up to the dream. So there I am at, and they're lighting fireworks, and I can see off to the left is a body of water. And when the fireworks are lit off and they're exploding in the sky, the water starts to go to and fro like an earthquake. Then the next thing is I realize that the body of water looks like the Washington Monument. You know, the reflecting pool out that reflects the monument up to the sky. And it's swaying like there's an earthquake. And somehow I'm, you know, I guess I'm in the White House, and I'm friends with the people there, right? I'm friends with the, must be Romney and Ryan. Because I'm welcome there. It's like, I may be even living there. I don't know. But I'm friends with them. And then I notice that people are looking kind of sickly and the ground is burning and there's magma seeping, getting onto the floor of the house. And I'm not sure now if it's the White House or some other place. And it's getting all over the streets. It's oozing up and it's filling everything, and everything is dying from that magma. And it feels horrific. And I realize, oh my gosh, the thing you least expected is going on. There's earthquakes and magma going on across the globe. And then I wake up and I think, Lord, is that like a Planet X thing? Or obviously there's big earth changes coming. And all these plans we have, being in the next Olympics and politics and lighting off fire, I suppose the fireworks, it was a warm outside, so it must have been July 4th. July 4th, 2013? Magma. I don't know what date it is. But the magma, of course, is, you know, game over, right? I mean, that's it. Didn't draw any conclusion other than we were trying to avoid the magma. There was a certain kind of camaraderie then. There were no enemies suddenly. When the magma appeared, suddenly we all dropped our enmity toward each other, whatever it is. Jealousy, you know, the stuff between people. All that was out the window. We were all in the same boat. We were all going to die. There was no more hatred, no more contest, no more my daddy is better than your dad. None of that. That all goes out. Look, that goes out. This is the point I'm trying to make. We're all, even though individuals, we're in this boat together. And you can't count anyone out. And you can't be enemies with anyone because we're all, you know, though we're individuals, we're all the same in the sense that we share the air. We're all going to die. We all are headed, you know, the ship is sinking for us all. There is no point to fight each other or to be mad at each other or to hold a grudge against each other at all. We're all, and in that point, of course, there was finally cooperation and love between people. Sadly, it took that to bring people together. I'm reminded when Ronald Reagan pointed to the sky and said, what if there's an enemy out there? We would all have to band together to fight this enemy from outer space. We would all be together. There wouldn't be any fighting amongst us. I contend, and I want to conclude, by saying the fighting that you seem to perceive now between liberals, conservatives, Satanists, fake Christians, Muslims, all the kind of whatever it is, the ongoing sort of spiritual civil war that goes on between people and within ourselves equally. And a lot of the fighting, we just export our own conflict onto other people. Now they become the enemy when they're not really the enemy. Satan would love us to divide us and have us against each other so that we would just kill each other and he would win. I mean, he's basically the god of death in a sense, that what he wants is the end of humanity as we know it. All of this goes out the window when we all know, if we all knew we were going to die and there was magma and the earth was, rocking out and that was the end of that, we would hug one another and there would be no enemy. That being said, we're also led by the spirit of who to talk to, who not to talk to, who to embrace, who not to embrace. You can't do it all. You can't just go out and be suddenly take this experience and go, oh, I'm friends with everybody. No, it doesn't really work like that because the Lord has a path for you to go on. Some people you deal with, some you don't. You there's billions of people, and if you started trying to say yes to everything, you go, hamana, hamana, yes, 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 you wind up with a complete confused conflict. So yes, there's discrimination. There's a path. There's yes, this direction, no to that direction. There's all that goes on. That's called wisdom. But at the end of the day, there is no enemy. It's within ourselves, the conflict. It's there is no getting back what we lost. There is no real peace except to be stopping with self-regard and to be still in God, in Christ, in Creator. That's the only place there is any peace. Now, if my dream was prophetic, then perhaps there is an earth event. I used to have John Moore on the air, and he would talk about the Gulf Stream and the waters rising up and over, and now I'm adding to it. I'm saying, well, what I saw was earthquakes everywhere, in diverse places, and magma. Oddly, it was on, while lighting fireworks at the White House. Don't know what it means. But it wasn't from a terrorist. It was the earth. It wasn't from an enemy like, whoever it is, Muslims, whatever it is, domestic terrorism. It had nothing to do with any of that. It had to do with the fact that, well, this is it for the earth. Bye. All those things become irrelevant. Your guilds, your associations, your fraternities, your sororities, your secret special military units, your elite corporate companies, your cutting-edge technologies, your powerful politicians, it's all out the window if there's magma on the ground. The status is lost. And, oddly, at that point there was kind of a peace because all the infighting was over. There's nothing I would rather see than people love one another and for Christians to stop just assuming that the other guy is going to hell if he, right? And that there could be cooperation, communication, humility, respect. There's nothing I would like better than to see something like that occur on this earth. But alas, that's not what this is for. This is for individuals to make a decision and follow through on that decision and be tested and tried for that decision. You can serve the devil or you can serve the Lord, but you're going to serve somebody. Yes, Mr. Bob Dylan, that's right. At this late age, I try to refrain from saying, well, Bobby, he was down now, and they rejected Jesus, and now he's going to hell. I want to reject that kind of thinking, because it's not my business. He did write a very profound song. He was absolutely spot on. These songwriters are all trying to figure out, again, how do we have peace? What good is it if people that say they care about the poor are yelling and screaming at the other side politically and name-calling and saying, you people are hypocrites, you're doing this and that, you know, you're being unfair in the press and you're lying about us and you're this and you're that. Well, so they complain about the very thing that they're doing, which is hypocrisy on steroids. I suppose that we can't get away from that in the political discourse, which now is just gossip and yelling and screaming. Will we ever, as a people, and now I mean all people, will we ever cooperate? And the answer is, unless there's some kind of catastrophic event, it may not be so. Can we work it out so where there's peace amongst us? Not as long as you have certain people on the earth that say, like, unless there's Sharia law and it's going to be global, and if you don't conform to it, we're going to go ahead and cut your head off. Now, there's conformity, all right, but it's in the public square. The irony of this, the artist, is they tout themselves as nonconformists and rugged individuals, only to find that, in the end, they bowed down to get their fame and fortune. So there is another illusion, a great pretender, as Jackson Brown talked about in his song. And they start off young and strong, fighting the world, fighting to conform, fighting to be individual, fighting for freedom, only to surrender in exchange for the filthy lucre. But you see, when there's magma, Mr. Brown, all bets are off. There is no Satanism on that day. And my prediction would be on something like that, the human being would help the other human being no matter what their affiliation, no matter what their background, no matter who they bowed down to. None of it matters in that moment, because in the end, until the final curtain, it ain't over. You may have bowed down to the devil to get something and been a great pretender yourself, but it's not over for you. You can always decide not to. You see, that's the thing with Jesus. It, at any point, there is forgiveness if you lay it down. But, you know, God's going to want you naked. You know, it's going to want you to be truthful. And we've all served the devil whenever we have had a harsh word, abusive to someone else, selfish. We've all served the devil in that capacity. You know, we might not have been structural Satanists as like a religion, but we've all been satanic, because we have a split within us that you know, a split in our DNA, a split in our psyche, something that is we call the fall of man. We call the curse of sin that we carry with us. And so any of us is capable of any time of serving Satan and bowing down and conforming and becoming Joseph Stalin, becoming a Nazi brown shirt, turning our parents in and all kinds of things like that, turning our fellow Jews in to at Auschwitz for an extra steak dinner. We're all capable, and yes, it would be easy for all of us to do just that. So nobody has virtue above anybody else in the end. I just wanted to show you how a bowing down over here innocently in your club ends up being murder over there, ends up being equal with everything that you complain about, thus making you a hypocrite. When you erect your churches but kill the prophets and kill Jesus at the same time, like if he showed up, how long do you think it would be before the official Christian church takes him out if he were to show up again? I contend that it wouldn't be long at all. I contend that any of us at any time could decide, for whatever reason, our kid needs baby's milk, you know, food, all right? The kids are starving. So I'm going to do this little thing here, and that's going to make it so my kid isn't starving. Even if it hurts somebody else, I don't care. The important thing is, I got it done. I fed my family. Who the heck are you to judge? Well, I'm not judging. It sounds like you're the one who's judging yourself, or you're upset. So if anyone mentions anything, you bark at them, but really you're the one conflicted, and you're exporting that to other people, your own conflict. And when that becomes a war, like the Islam, then there's a problem. So I look at this conundrum, and I realize in the end, I don't have to say a cliche that love is the answer, but God is love, and that love is the answer. If somehow we could change to be like, or be changed to be like, you know, knowing that magma is not going to be on the ground, you know, we're all kind of, you know, suddenly we have to kind of, you know, our hearts open up and we want to help the other person avoid being hurt or burned or whatever. There are no Christians, Muslims, Republicans, Democrats, you know, skull and bones, this and that, all the evils of the world, FEMA, this, that, all the Nazis, all the conspiracy things, everything. That conspiracy blogs just mean, you know, the government is the enemy and so we're going to hate on them, you know, and then basically, then they start arresting the people who are doing the conspiracy blogs, and then they go, you see? It's like, well, yeah, but dude, you're hating them by broadcasting all this hatred toward the government. Then when they come to pick you up, it's you're begging for it, right? I mean, it's just like, can't you see that? I personally am not interested in the conspiracy stuff. I kind of looked at the FEMA camps and the, you know, what was it, the troops training here for a domestic, civil war. The detention camps that they're going to lock everyone into to stop them from having a civil war, the gun confiscation, getting used to having, you know, foreign troops on the ground here, and all the other things that are indeed, you know, anti-American, at the very least. But, you know, you wonder, well, how is this possible? The government not even talking about this. And it's possible because, you know, what it proves is that I'm right in saying that this world is more a grand illusion. In other words, you know, you don't live in a country you think you live in. You don't have, you know, people aren't going by the documents you think are the founding documents. There's all kinds of stuff that's anomalous to what world you think you live in going on that proves that your perception of the world and my perception of the world is false. And so what I look at that gives me a lot of hope is, yeah, well, how come I'm still walking around and able, here I am at becoming a senior citizen, and I'm a senior, and being able to have my thoughts and my art and my stuff there must be a great restrainer somewhere that allows me to speak to you in a very candid manner and really kind of, I guess the reason I'm speaking to you is to apply my gift to this problem of humanity and to be able to show from the micro to the macro and all points in between the situation we are in, to exemplify it for you so that you can understand what peace is versus this quest for peace that will never come. You know, if I go and when you're a young man, you're concerned of making a living, having a family, and this and that, and you're going to bow down to certain things. And, you know, when your boss tells you to do something, you're going to do it. And you're not going to think of if it's evil or not. You're just going to want to get it done and then move up the ladder as quickly as you can. Forget about the kind of awful things you had to do in the beginning or the awful jobs you had in the beginning to get up the ladder so that you don't have those anymore. And I'm just telling you that that's what a lot of people call the rat race. And in the end, if we're all going to die tomorrow, it's irrelevant, yes? So peace won't be being successful and running up, you know, being a rat in a maze and finding where the cheese is. That's not going to make you happy. That's not going to be allow you to die. That's going to keep you hanging on and keep you attached And attachment is going to be cause great suffering to you, your family, and everyone around you who's in the same boat. And the message of Jesus is a message of peace, eternity, transformation, a new heaven and a new earth. Indeed, what they say of the Lord, the Bible says, He makes all things new, both in the Old and New Testaments. Jesus makes new heaven, new earth. Jesus being ultimately revealed as the Word of God, which is also the Creator. So, put your faith and hope in Him, and you can't miss. And stop making... Look, they laugh at me, okay? Because I take all this so seriously, I get so bummed out. You know, I'm so bad at following my own advice, I can't even do it. And they laugh. It's like, you know, here you are, you know the truth, and there's peace right here. It's not that important. You know, it doesn't really matter. And you're taking it all so seriously.
Look, they're persecuting me. I didn't do anything wrong, and then they just do something.
You know, like that. And I'm sorry. I repent. I apologize. If any of you have known me and I've done that very thing and complained with 5 loaves of bread under my arm, I'm really sorry. You're just going to have to find it in your heart to forgive me for being such an idiot. You know. I could put it, that's not as succinct as I'd like to say. I'm going to have to find it in my heart to forgive myself for being such an idiot. And getting on my high horse and calling them all commies and chastising them as some other species of being, I'm just going to have to find it in my heart to forgive myself because I get frustrated and I say things like that and I'm sorry. You want to hear the most stupid thing I've done lately? Really? Just to show you that I'm a retard, you want to know? Is when I'll make an axiomatic statement to my wife, Trish, and say, you know, I'm not letting any of them in my house, when I say them, I mean Democrats, liberals, all commies. I'm not letting them in my house. I don't want them on the property. And of course, that's the silliest thing on earth to say. That proves that I've learned nothing from my own talks. We'll actually get to a point. Funny that their neighbor is working on the Obama re-election campaign, and she has been here in the house a couple of times. You know what I mean? And Trish always tries to talk to her about how awful Obama is, and she starts laughing. So, you know, we got to... I know how dumb this looks. I know. But still I'm here, and I want to bite into the apple of something real every once in a while. You know, like a political campaign, right? Get you know, in other words, I'm still going to go to the football game. I'm still going to, you know... I'm not saying anything, Trish. Don't worry. Your precious political battle is still...
That was easy.
Trish, she's hitting me with that button. That was easy. Come on, Trish. I'm not... I'm philosophical today. And so, you know, I'm basically explaining the situation. And don't worry. By this afternoon, I'll be reeled back into it and feeling frustrated like everybody else. That being said, I pray for our nation, you know, and but when the magma comes, there are no nations, right? I pray for our troops, I pray for our nation, I pray for our people to come together, to unite, despite whatever their bag is, you know. I pray for peace among musicians all the time, that the satanic ones and the Christ-centered ones would stop fighting each other. Stop making it personal. And I pray for the athletes, that wouldn't come between athletes, you know. But apparently, it's just like cats and dogs. But see, the funny thing is, it's the cat or dog in you. It's not you. So in this hour and 2-hour period, we've solved it all. We solved the problems of all the world. Amen. If you want to cut it off there, Frankie, that could be a 2 hours right there. Boom. Cut it right here. Cut. And then I'll go on a couple more minutes. So how do we live, to kind of quote Francis Schaeffer, the author, how do we live now that we know what we know? How now do we live? And the answer to that is, not my way, Lord, but your way. Not my thought, Lord, but your thought. Not what I want, Lord, but what you want and what I can do to get into your will to help bring about what your will is, not mine. I must shrink, Lord, you must grow. And that's the way to peace. And that's the way to have a peaceful heart. And that's the way to have a peaceful countenance. And that's the way to be at peace no matter what situation you find yourself in. If the satanic people want to throw you into the fire or throw you to the lions because you're not like them and you're the lamb and they're the wolves, then God must have put you there for that reason. I mean, you got to keep going back to him. Keep going back to him. You know, meaning like Stephen being stoned, okay? Jesus being crucified. You know, being put in oil. Being crucified upside down. Being stoned to death. Being left to become an Egyptian slave. Being with God doesn't prevent any of these things from happening, really. It's each one of those is like a test to see what you will do in that context. It's easy to go to the Lord constantly when you've got very little or nothing. It's hard to go to the Lord when you have lots of things and a position somewhere and people to deal with and you know, cell phone calls to return and emails to deal with and responsibilities. It's all what that is just a test to see who you will serve. And if you're one of those kind of people that's like a busy manager type, then Lord, what should I do about this employee? What should I do about that employee? What should I do next, Lord? What should be my focus? And bring him in on that process, and that's basically another way to peace. That's a way to peace. Anything else, falls on your shoulders, and you could fail. The people that trust the Lord in their businesses tend to do better than the people that are going by their own understanding, because you don't know all the ins and outs of everything. You can't be, but the Lord does. So that's, you know, it's always going to be him as a way to peace. And it's never going to be us as having a solution. You've seen Obama out there saying that the rights flow from the government, you know, trying to make that argument, and that we should bail out every company, meaning we should take over, the government should take over every company that's failing, you know, which then justifies that he'll bankrupt every company, then take them all over to become a centralized state, and that's basically socialism and communism. So he's out there now basically putting forth the case without hiding it anymore for communism and Marxism since the appointment of Ryan on the Republican ticket. He's been out there just openly saying we should all have the same outcome and we should take over every business and so we don't lose any workers. And it's all 100% deception. So that's why we work for the other side, because they say publicly that the rights flow from God, not the government. That's good enough for me, and that's all I need to know to be unabashedly on the side of Romney and Ryan. I don't care if he's a Mormon. I don't care if he's a Catholic. I don't care. I've gotten to the point where if you say your rights come from the Creator, I'll sign up. I'll work for you. You know, tell me what to do. No, I'm not bowing down. I'm just saying, you know, I believe my heart, in my heart, I have that cause. And, you know, that's, I pray to the Lord, you want me to help with that? And it's like, okay, so there's something to do. All right. Is that going to solve all our problems? No. But it means I'm willing to take ridicule and horrible, angry comments, which I do take. When I comment on Breitbart, I comment somewhere about, you know, it's just horrible, people calling me deluded and racist and, you know, feeling I should be, you know what I mean, for not doing anything. I mean, that's just the war as it is today. But will I stand for rights flow from God, not from government? And will I stand on that publicly? You bet I will. And no, I don't believe that war has been canceled yet. So yeah, we have to have troops to defend, you know, I understand. It's complicated, but you know, I see people every day talking about, especially Ron Paul supporters, talking about there shouldn't be any war. Well, look, friend, you may be a great idealist, but there's, God is not, in his plan, is not the end of war right now. Everyone's going to die anyway. So that's, war is really kind of, you know, we should stop war. Or how about this one? We should get all caught up with the gay marriage issue and all these other distractions. No, I, you know, if you want to say to me that the Bible, that's right, I quit talking about 5 minutes ago. Now I'm just babbling. If you want to say to, you can turn it off now. Go ahead. That, you've heard the meat of it. Go ahead. I'll see you later. Okay, so I'm going to finish this. If you were to say to me that the Bible is hate speech because it's against homosexuality, so therefore it's going to be outlawed, and if you were to be found with the Bible, you go to jail, I will go to jail, and I will say that I believe in the Bible, publicly. Even though gay political activists who are basically Antichrist, you know, have given themselves over to the Antichrist, it's not about their gayness, it's about getting rid of the Bible and using them to do just that. Well, what does that prove? When I see our own government touting communism and the ways of Satan, i.e. The social mores, and trying to make conformity today is not like it was in, you know, when I was a child. Conformity today is literally being, whether you are this way or not, becoming at least bisexual and leftist. I mean, if you want a job in Hollywood, you're going to have to do that. You have to be, you know, open, willing. That's what bowing down is today. I don't know what it'll be tomorrow. You know, maybe agreeing to become a robot. No, I don't know. But I'm just saying that it all works toward Antichrist. Everything is working toward that goal. If we have to use the gays to get rid of the Bible, so be it. Rahm Emanuel has publicly renounced the Bible. He's renounced the Torah. Obama has blasphemed God in the public place. He's even referred to himself as God, misusing one of the Psalms. In other words, he's applying scripture to himself as God. I've seen that. Do you need any more proof that it's all about that? It's all about Satan. It's all about Satan versus God. The whole damn thing. So, and Satan has the power of making sure that you know, he might say, I'll help you recapture your youth in those golden moments when you were a kid that you're trying to build your house and build this and build that and become rich enough so you can have that, you know, I'll help you do all that if you bow down to me. But bowing down to me will be bowing down to someone who's above you who can make that happen, but I'll be the one possessing that person at that moment. Play your cards right, follow the rules, as Bill Clinton would say. You too can have the American dream. But the American dream went out the window because it was really the satanic dream, which is an illusion. And again, the guy's a liar. He doesn't have to pay you or make you a rock star. He'll promise you that going in, but it never really works out. Feel comfortable, especially if you have a church that's, you know, interconnected with Babylon. Feel free to walk out if you like it. You're not going to lose God if you leave a church that's sold out to the world at all. I know. You're afraid of the hard road of not having friends, not being able to worship and with the choir and with the music, and not being able to go read the books by these various Christian authors and have discussions and have bake sales and have something to do on the weekends and go to, you know, the fast food thing and the barbecue and the, yeah, I know. I know. It's awful. Look, my heart goes out to you. I know. your suffering. But at the end of the day, you're going to have to trust the Lord and not man. And not yourself, and not your own understanding. You read that in the Bible all the time. Rely not on your own understanding, the Lord says, in the Old and New Testament. Okay, so basically that's an important thing. When it's kind of repeated in both, it's very important. And what does it mean? It means that the world is so effed up and so impossible to figure out, even though I've come as close as you could possibly come. I've come as close as any human being could to actually getting the structure of it down. And still, I have to leave the paradox in a box sealed up that I can't get into. You know, I mean, but at least I could get to that point. And it does me no good. In fact, I've got about as good of understanding of this grand illusion as anyone. And I'm telling you, there's no way to solve it. That's my point. You can't solve it, and neither can I. And neither can Einstein, for that matter. The only way there is to peace is Jesus. The only peace that I know is saying, Lord, which way? When I'm all alone, saying, Lord, hello. When I'm looking at the stars at 4 a.m, and I'm standing there all alone out there on the porch looking up, I say, Lord, what would you like me to think about today? Lord, it's about you, not me. Lord, guide me to the next step. Lord, show me who I should call on the telephone. Lord, please shield me from the arrows that fly, you know, the Psalm 91 arrows and darts and things. Protect me from all the things that are trying to bring us all down. Lord, restore in me a new heart and a new mind. Let me be with you in the kingdom, even though I still have to walk it out on earth. Well, if you'd like that, son, then it would be my will, not yours, because your way would bring pain and my way would bring happiness. Even though it's counterintuitive. I know that. Lord, I'm stuck in my church. I know something's wrong. What can we do? How could I... You want me to just walk out? It's all so lonely. You want me to say something to the pastor? Well, let me save you some time. I've actually tried to help the pastors, you know, come to Jesus. You know, trust him and not mammon, right? And I was thrown out. I didn't do it in bed. I was very nice. I'm a nice person. I'm not, you know, I believe in following the rules. And, you know, I have pretty good appearance. I don't look scary, you know, but... They're not interested in that, and they're interested in surviving as an organization and not being harassed by, you know, the government or other people or whatever, and not being under suspicion, which is exactly what would happen if one went, you know, rogue and went off the 501c3 and went underground, you know, like the church in China. It's not tolerated in America. It's just, you know... If you like, they're already here. They already won, you know, if you like. I mean, you could look at it that way in a spiritual way. But then again, it's not about them or the collective. It's about you. I can't tell you what you should. I know a lot of people that are serving the church who are underground themselves, who are working to reform the church, the 501c3 church, to make it something acceptable to God and... You know, and they like everyone there, and they're all pretty good people. And the only little problem they have is that they owe their sustenance and existence to, you know, the wrong, not to the source, but to the anti-source, if you will. And since it's not really publicized, and since it's not really, you know, big news or anything, they just feel that under the cover of darkness, they can just continue on. And I know that there's, you know, people wonder, well, how come no one's worried about these churches? They pray in these churches. How come no one's worried about it? The communists, the atheists, the whole Antichrist thing just has walked right into America and taken over. They're not worried at all about the churches, but they should be. Because prayer is the antidote for what I'm talking about. They're not worried, not one bit. Just like in China, there's a whole overground, you know, church that's there. That's like the 501c3 system, and the Chinese government leaves them alone completely. They only go after that underground church. But the church there, George Bush in the last Olympics, he visited the church in China. All the churches, they're all out there for everyone to see. China is the best example of what I'm talking about. When you belong to a church in China, you will not be harassed. You're encouraged to go to that church. They want you to go to church. But if you're caught in that underground church that's not registered with the state, pobrecito, you go to prison. Gosh, they're still reading out of the same Bible. How is that possible? Now, Brother Z, you can't tell me that the same thing that happened in China would happen here. Oh, yes, it would. You try to not have a church that's not 501c3? In other words, not the official state-owned church like in China. We have our churches here are exactly like the state church in China. If you were to set up a church, you know, a functioning in the same form where people would show up somewhere and whatnot, I guarantee you'd be harassed. And you'd be a suspicion. And agent provocateurs could show up and do some awful thing and blame you. You know, that's that kind of intimidation is what would happen right off the bat. Is this America? Land of the free, home of the brave, when that kind of thing would happen? No, it's a globalist totalitarian state where that happens. It's a military dictatorship where that happens. Oh, it happens in America. Yeah, okay, well then, game over, right? Obviously, we're relying on God to change that. There is no difference between the state-run... George Bush felt very welcome going into the state-run church just like he does in his own church in Texas. Because they're identical. The system we have of church here in America is identical to China and Russia and everywhere else. They're the state... Because they like church, because they have the right to keep track of the people there. And it creates an easy way to spy on them. And, you know, it's a body that can be manipulated pretty easily by the pastor, so they like that. They like the idea that they could talk to this guy and he represents all these people and they could shift the message to give messages like... Did you know there's an overt church in Adolf Hitler's time? In Germany, there was the official church and it was intact and cooperating with Hitler. I rest my case, really. I mean, you know, this shouldn't even have to be a discussion about this. But again, is America the land of the free when if you were to set up your own group to worship, they would, you know, you would be under harassment? That should not be legal in a free country. You should be free to worship as you see fit. And if you want to make a tax donation agreement with the government, you should do that as you see fit. Or not do that as you see fit, and there should be no harassment either way. But there is. You know, there's the same exact harassment to the underground church here, and I have no doubt there's an underground church, meaning where people get together in secret locations or whatever they do. But what they're looking for is to send people in there, or maybe capture someone and make them into a mind-control robot to go shoot some people, and then blame the church, then outlaw the Bible. You know, it's this... Same conflict. None of us escapes. We're here on this earth not to do our own thing, but to deal with this conflict. It's the same thing. It deals with God and Satan, the Bible, the Word of God, and, you know, the freedom, you know, and freedom and rights flow from the Creator versus freedom and rights flow from the state. This conflict, this ancient conflict, is a spiritual battle. It's playing right out before our eyes. Everything Obama says is spiritual, not geopolitical. when he talks about creating the same outcome for everybody, that's a spiritual statement saying communism and atheism are my way, and my own power is going to be great, where I will make everyone else small underneath me in a dictatorship or whatever. That's the spirit of what's going on. And the only reason they want communism is because those people that are the leaders would be, you know, made fabulously rich at the top. And there'd be a very small group of them, and a great, to get that kind of power and wealth, everyone else would be subjected to them as slaves, as serfs. And if anyone disagrees with that, they can be eliminated. And that's the kind of power they would like to have. America was the only thing that stood against it. We have a long way to go if we're ever going to clean it up, including harassment of people that want to have church. I don't know that it's possible, but it is something worth fighting for, I suppose. It's something definitely worth fighting for politically. And will freedom reign in America? I don't know, because it's not that way now. It's we're under a state of emergency and, you know, Homeland Security and Patriot Act. I don't think so. It does looks to me more like apocalyptic. Okay? Like we're going into an apocalyptic situation. And that's the meaning of the magma, that, you know, there's some kind of event that's coming up where that would threaten massive life upon the earth. And this may be imminent. And the government may even know about it. But, I mean, the point is, it's always going to be about that. You got to be right with the Lord at all times. At all times. Be ready to give an account to Him, because you never know when you're going to die or how much time we have. Every day is a gift. And seek the Lord for all things and what you should do, what you should eat, what you should wear. And by all means, do not worry. If you find yourself worrying, then you're doing it wrong. You're relying on your own understanding. You're carrying the weight on your own shoulders. Don't do that. There is nothing good in the flesh. The flesh profits nothing. There is no solution, in other words, that man can come up with that will solve anything, really. You know, we all have to be led by the Lord, or divinely led, in order to come up with anything good. Anything good that I've ever done, even if I haven't given acknowledgement to the Lord, it's when I think about it, looking back on it, everything I've done that's been any good has been divinely led. Divinely led. Even if I thought I came up with it or people gave me credit for it, it was a divine leading that actually got... Nothing in my life that's good came by my complete understanding without being guided. And I'm very aware of that. And so I tend to always think when I'm over my head, Lord, you're going to have to show me the way because I can't figure it out. And He loves it when you say that. He loves it when you put it that way. Shalom, shalom. I'm going to go now. And I hope... you're all good, and you kind of got the message. And let this be like a chiropractic adjustment. You know, I hope you found it amusing about my own my own home improvement. No, I've done it. I've done it in the past, and, you know, it was a way of making a living at one point. And I'm kind of too old for that. I'm really more like an artist, musician, and, you know, I'm kind of like, that's where I see my future in terms of, you know, I just want to do that. I love sound, you know. And part of my dream was that I discovered a sound that could do things, that could create, you know, realms and open up portals into other, that manipulated time and space, you know, that there were tones out there. I keep thinking this, and, you know, so that's something to explore. Wouldn't it be great if there could be a God tone that if you just went around blasting the God tone out, the God frequency, everyone just started praying? You know, wouldn't that be great? Everyone started loving one another? The love frequency, the love bomb. Wouldn't it be amazing if there was this one frequency you could blast the world, everyone would be at peace? Without it, I'll see you next time. Zeph Daniel out.